One of the challenges of building a stream processing platform is finding the right balance between ease of use and expressiveness. My name is Mark, and with me is Sujay and Gil from the Data Platform team. Today, we'll be discussing the streaming SQL processor on Data Mesh and how it addresses this challenge. We'll start by giving a quick overview of what stream processing is and why it's important for data engineering today. Next, Gil will give us a quick overview of Data Mesh platform at Netflix. And after that, Sujay will present the new Data Mesh SQL processor that we've been working on. The SQL processor is designed to simplify stream processing and make it more accessible to data engineers and data scientists. And we'll talk about its key features, how it works, and how it can benefit real-time data processing at Netflix. So stream processing is the processing of data in motion, that is, computing on data directly as it's produced or received. This computing paradigm is commonly associated with processing of real-time data, as most data is created as continuous streams. So as an example, a Netflix user browsing the home page generates a stream of activities. The data is created as a series of events over time. So what is the difference between stream processing and a well-known pattern like batch processing? Well, in stream processing, you model your data as unbounded streams, which has a start but no end. Whereas in batch processing, the data set you're processing has both a start and an end. In unbounded streams, they don't terminate, and it provides data as it's generated, and as a result, it must be continuously processed. It's not possible to wait for all input data to arrive because the input is unbounded and will not complete at any point in time. Processing unbounded data often requires that events are ingested in a certain order, such as order in which the events have occurred, to be able to reason about the result completeness. But on the other hand, batch processing works with bounded stream with the start and an end. It can be processed by ingesting all the data before performing any computation, and ordered ingestion is not required because you can always sort your data set. So why is this useful? You can model your real-time data processing as a stream processing application by modeling your data as unbounded streams. As a result, you don't have to wait until the defined end time of your batch to react or gain insights from your real-time data. And at Netflix, we leverage a couple different stream processing engines to implement these real-time processing applications. For processing analytical data, we heavily leverage Apache Flink framework. So let's take a look at some of the use cases which leverage stream processing to power real-time data at Netflix. One category of use cases is the data pipeline applications, such as Keystone routers and data mesh processors. And in these applications, real-time events are transported via a streaming data transport, such as a Kafka topic, and ingested by stream processing applications. The processed data is then written out to downstream data stores in real time, such as to an Iceberg table or to another Kafka topic. The routers and processors are stream processing building blocks that Data Platform team operates. To leverage these building blocks, you can provision them through the UI without having to write any code. Another category of use cases at Netflix includes custom stream processing applications developed by other engineers. These applications are typically written in Java and Scala using the low-level Flink Data Stream API. So here are some key examples of stream processing apps that power real-time data at Netflix. So the widely known examples are the apps operated by the Consolidated Logging team. They power the firehose of event logs from client devices while enriching and processing these events in real time. Streaming Client Impressions app produces the client impressions F table in real time, which is widely used across the DSC org. And Pluid is a stateful stream processing application, which provides user session data to power real-time machine learning use cases such as adaptive rows. So currently, how can data engineers at Netflix leverage stream processing to process data in real time. One option is to leverage the high-level building blocks, such as Keystone routers and data mesh processors offered by the data platform. As mentioned earlier, you can set up the pipeline without writing any code just by provisioning through the UI. But if your use case doesn't fit into the patterns that are solved through existing processors, you would have to write a custom stream processing application using the lower level data stream API. However, this has a high learning curve and is more complicated than simply leveraging the high level building blocks.
Let's talk about the building blocks that the platform team and Netflix operates. Data mesh. Data mesh offers sources as an abstraction to stream processing. Sources can contain events from change data capture from transactional databases, such as MySQL, Postgres, CockroachDB. These events can be further processed by filters or enriched by GraphQL processor. It's possible also for applications to produce events via a producer library. Then these events can be further written into one of the supported connectors, such as Elasticsearch for search and Kibana dashboards, Iceberg, our big data table format, or Kafka for further stream processing. Let's dive a little bit deeper into the supported transform patterns by the data mesh platform. So at the top, we have these two platform provided transforms, a filter, which allows users to discard events using an XPath language or project a certain types of fields. Additionally, events can be enriched via GraphQL, which calls a federated graph search. On the other hand, if the user use case does not satisfied by the platform provided transforms, users can build a custom Flink job using the data stream API. As you can see, there is a large gap between the platform provided building blocks and then going all the way down to the user data stream API. Our goal is to provide a better abstraction using SQL, a language that data engineers and software engineers are commonly using. SQL processor will be leveraged by Data Mesh, a managed platform. Let's talk a little bit about the benefits of relying on a centralized platform. First, a standard set of metrics and alerts and logs can be emitted from the jobs. Also, these jobs can be scaled up and down according to traffic patterns. We have thousands of jobs at Netflix today that scales from megabytes per second to gigabytes per second. Also, alerts can be routed to the platform team. These alerts can be remediated in certain cases of transient errors. Last but not least, the platform teams handle software upgrades and also integrated the Netflix ecosystem on security for authorization and authentication.
Let's consider an example. Let's say we have a stream of Netflix play events, and we want to get a sense of how popular a certain movie or show is doing in a window of, let's say, a few minutes, hours, or days. The stream contains details like movie information, device information, some profile information of the user. And basically, we want to calculate for each movie or show how often it's been started in custom time windows. If we were to build a Flink job to solve this problem, we'd have to consider a few things. We would create the code repository, create the Flink app itself. We'd have to think about how the app is being deployed and managed. Eventually, once the app is up and running, we'd have to think about metrics, alerts, monitoring in general, and software upgrades as well. Then we get to writing the code. This is typical data stream API code that many of you might be familiar with. To begin with, we get the stream execution environment, and then we set up the source and the sync. Here, there is no sync, we're just printing to the console. But typically, we would want to send this data over to a data store or Kafka. There's a few things to consider while setting up the source and the sync. We want to think about serialization, deserialization, connectivity to the source and the sync. We may need to think about whether the source and the sync exist, and what are the best practices when it comes to connectivity. Are these connections secure? Are the data stores secure? And things like that. Then we get to the actual core logic of the application. As you can see, we are taking these play events, filtering them by the device type, keying by the movie title. And then we have to implement our own aggregation and potentially a transformation function. There's a few things to consider here. There are some low-level details when it comes to writing an aggregation function, like how should the merge method within the aggregation function look like. As you can see, it's a bunch of code, and it needs familiarity with the DataStream API, with the Flink ecosystem, and if you're writing the app in Java, then familiarity with the Java or Scala ecosystem. If we were to do this in SQL, this is what the query would look like. It's less verbose, there's less boilerplate code, so less chances of bugs. We are using some built-in functions. Tumble here is a window table valued function which can be used for windowing. So it's easier to read and understand. Let's pause here for a second and think about what this means. SQL is well understood in the industry. It's almost a standard way of interacting with data. So we believe it's easier to use than the DataStream API in general. With SQL, it's possible to write complex stream processing logic using familiar constructs like select, where, group by, join. So we believe it allows more people to start using stream processing. SQL can be productive in some cases. It's less verbose, fewer lines of code, and developers can focus on the actual business logic of the application as opposed to worrying about low-level details like Flink checkpointing and buffering and fault tolerance and things like that. And SQL can also be more optimized, more performant in some cases, because Flink SQL uses an optimizer which generates efficient execution plans. It can essentially leverage the Flink runtime to write highly optimized code. However, it's not a replacement for the DataStream API. I think DataStream API still makes a lot of sense when you want low-level, fine-grained control over the processing logic. Ultimately, whether to use SQL or DataStream API really depends on a case-by-case basis. Our goal here is to just give users more choice. This is a data mesh pipeline that's running the same SQL query. On the left-hand side, you see a data mesh source, which is receiving the stream of play events that we just spoke about. In the center is a SQL processor, which is essentially a Flink job running the SQL query. And on the right-hand side are an iceberg and an Elasticsearch sink that the data is being written to. On top of the value that SQL provides, data mesh here provides some additional value. For example, the users don't really have to think about serialization, deserialization of the data that's flowing through. It's all handled by the platform behind the scenes. Metrics, alerting, monitoring is handled by the data mesh team in general. Schema is an important aspect when dealing with data. Data mesh handles schema management, schema evolution, all the way from the source to the sink, as a platform. And then we've also tried to use some best practices when it comes to using Avro schemas, connectivity with Kafka, and using secure data stores, and things like that. It also allows extensibility. You can do further processing downstream. You can attach more processors after the SQL processor, and so on and so forth. Let's dive into the schema aspect a little bit. On the left-hand side is a source, the source that's receiving these play events. And on the bottom, you see the schema associated with the source. It contains the information that we just spoke about, movie profile, et cetera. The SQL processor has the ability to infer schema. So every time you change a SQL query, the output schema could look different. And using the schema inference, you would generate the output schema that would then be used on the sinks. The other aspect of the SQL processor is the UI query editor. This is the same SQL query that we just saw. It has some built-in goodness, like being able to format your query. The query, as you're typing, gets validated against SQL syntax. Also, looking at validated against the input schema, if you're projecting columns that exist and things like that. And then there's an option to run the query. So early on in the project, we realized that to unleash the full potential of SQL, it would be great to give users the ability to run query interactively so that they can iterate on the query that they're writing, see the data, come back, and rewrite the query. So we built this mode to run queries interactively. And essentially, from the Data Mesh UI SQL processor, you can write your query, and then you can run it right away, and you'll see the results streaming in from the topics that are that the SQL processor is reading from. To summarize, SQL brings in some value on its own. It's well understood. And Data Mesh brings some additional value by being a managed platform. It has a rich connector ecosystem, allows composability and reusability. And we believe that by combining the two in a Data Mesh SQL processor, we would allow more users to start using stream processing for their use cases without needing to know the low-level details of writing and managing a Flink app. And that's it. We are still early on in our journey of the Data Mesh SQL processor, so we would love for you guys to partner with us, help shape the future of streaming SQL at Netflix. We have some early adopters, and we've received some very good feedback from them. So reach out to us at Data Mesh Support Slack channel, or check out our docs.